Hey, Bill Nye, the science guy here.
This is Salman Rushdie.
Hi, this is Julia Sweeney.
I'm Neil deGrasse Tyson.
This is Theo Wilson.
Hi, this is Dar Williams.
I'm Mr. Deity, and you're listening to the Humanist Hour. I command you to listen now, or I will smite you.
Yes, I am a sound scientist. Came to evaluate the evidence on a closed case, highly classified, confidential, in a race against the clock.
Hi, this is Todd.
And this is Kim.
Welcome to the Humanist Hour podcast.
Yes, welcome. Humanism is the joy that I feel when I wake up every day and have no idea what life is going to bring me.
That is beautiful. Almost profound.
I feel it. I feel it deeply.
Excellent. Oh, yeah. I slacking on the job. Forgot to mention, this is the official podcast of the American Humanist Association.
That was sounded very official.
It did sound official. I felt like I should give like one of those things they give during the NFL games, like any recording or broadcasting of this without the express written consent of the National Football League is expressly prohibited.
Except probably it should be from the American Humanist Association.
No. The NFL has full authority over the AHA, I think. I have to check that.
Who knew?
I'm almost certain. I mean, it makes logical sense. I would recommend you drop your skepticism now. This is.
I shall believe in you, Todd.
Indeed. So we have some, awesome guest, but he's so good he almost seems like plural. We have Marty Klein this month, who we will get to later, but the topic of this episode is sex, which is always fun. We do these once every year or so, and it's always a blast. But let's talk about some other fun things first. What's going on, Kim?
Well, I saw an interesting little piece that you had written in response to a town that was really upset about not being able to put a great big cross out front.
Oh, gosh. So this is Brandon, Mississippi. And just to give you a quick overview, just a one data point of what Brandon might be like. I've never been there. I'm sure it's lovely. I'm sure there's many great people there. But their elected representative in the Mississippi legislature last year publicly was talking about his feelings on gay people and quoted Leviticus 20 and how gay people should be killed and their blood would be on their own hand, and then was called out on it and would not back down or apologize. It's like, no. I feel like what the Bible says. It's like,
oh my gosh.
Wow, you are in the Stone Ages, Mr. Representative. So anyway, he's their representative. And this is a town that had to remove the Ten Commandments from inside the police headquarters when the FFRF got involved. And now a church was trying to put up a 110-foot-tall cross, which they were doing on private land. Bravo. That's not an issue. The issue was there's a city ordinance requiring buildings not be above, I think it was 20 feet tall. And this thing was like 5.5 times that size. And so they were asking for a special exemption for the cross because it would bring joy in the feeling of the Holy Spirit to all the motorists going down major Interstate 20 next to the church. And the Planning Commission recommended no, and the church started immediately accusing them of being afraid of Muslims and all this religious rhetoric. And so there was like a public hearing set and where the final decision was going to be made. Well, I have no problem with them wanting to put up a cross. I do have a problem with them asking for a special religious exemption. So I thought this would be, yeah, it just seemed a little unfair, right?
A little bit.
Well, as their government pointed out, if they start making exemptions for one group, they might have to make exemptions for other groups. And so I thought it might be good to provide a disincentive, which unfortunately I never got to use because the church ended up giving up and the issue died. But we were actually full plans ahead, even looking at real estate. I was going to buy a piece of real estate in Brandon, Mississippi, near the highway, and threaten to erect a 110-foot-tall obelisk. So basically the same design as the cross, just taking off the crossbeam, and then adding to the top an atheist logo and painting it rainbow colors top to bottom and calling it the Pride Tower.
Now, that sounds like a serious disincentive to some people. Now, I like it. I think we should do it anyway, but, you know, it's not my foundation. However, wow. So what did they say?
They only heard about it after they gave up. I posted on Facebook, like, look, I just recommend you not change your minds, because I my guess is you don't want this in your town. Like, a place like, many cities in the country would love to get a free Pride Tower. They'd be like, oh, this is a cool monument. Backwoods of Mississippi, representative that believes in killing gay people, yeah, they probably wouldn't want a beacon of pride and liberty in their backyard. So,
yeah.
I just thought the concept of a rainbow painted phallic symbol was hilarious to stick in their town if they were going to try to have special violations of the law.
I love that. And you know what? The chances of you actually being able to do that, I'm guessing someone else will give you an opportunity, perhaps. So let's put it that way.
I think there's going to be another opportunity, yes. So, you know, it was fun. They ruined my fun, though. I was looking for that, actually. But hey, the good guys win, and they didn't get their special religious privilege. So,
and I guess on the upside is the fact that at least the town did recognize that if they start giving exemptions, then there have to be more exemptions and more exemptions.
Exactly.
So, Todd, there is some big stuff coming up in the next month or so. It's been happening for a while. The anticipation has been building, and we've got a lot going on about something that's very close to your heart as well as mine, and I think a lot of humanists.
Indeed, we are in year two of the Foundation Beyond Belief Leukemia and Lymphoma Society project, where we are going to be doing the Light the Night Walks, and those are starting like right now. So if you haven't signed up yet, please do so. We need everybody to sign up. Please don't allow the bystander effect to take place and think, oh, somebody else will do it. No, we need everybody listening to get out there, sign up, join a team, and help raise money. It's such an amazing way and positive way to be out and open as a humanist and just raising money for scientific research to beat cancer. So go to FBBLLS, that's pronounced Fibbles, FBBLLS.org, and you can learn all sorts of stuff there. And by the way, just a forewarning, the page takes a long time to load. We have so many teams and people, not as many as we're going to need if we're going to hit our $500,000 goal, but we have so many we've kind of overwhelmed the LLS system, so the tech people are trying to figure out a way to get the page to load faster. But please go there, join a team, help us fundraise, and let's hit that $500,000 goal.
Yes, definitely. I'm doing my part. I know there's a lot of people out there, but I know there's a few more. So come on. And if you can't walk, it doesn't matter. Just go ahead and donate. Help somebody who is walking and help somebody with amazing ideas on how to cure cancer. Let's give them some money, honey.
Exactly. We're also organizing a Hug an Atheist Week, the first week in October across the country. So if you are part of a local group, please set up a table somewhere in a public area and basically give hugs away in exchange for donations to LLS. It's a cool event. You can learn a lot more, including ideas on how to do it, at foundationbeyondbelief.org/hugaheathen. And there's a lot of information there. And actually, a really cool thing, we just got a Penn Jillette just sent a picture of he and Teller combined, Penn and Teller, hugging with a little quote about his support. And of course, Teller didn't provide a quote because he's the silent type.
He's got two quotation marks with nothing in between.
Exactly. That's exactly right. So yeah, they're supporting it, and it's really awesome. Lots of cool stuff going on. So please get involved. Good stuff. So you became a celebrant recently, and actually, listeners, especially anybody who knows any gay folks in the military who might be, AHA is offering free celebrant services to perform same-sex weddings to members of the military, which is pretty cool. You could go to the American Humanist Association.org to learn more about that. But if you're looking to get married and want a free celebrant, we are happy to hook it up. So that's something pretty cool to know about.
Yay, humanists.
Woohoo!
We love them all.
Indeed. So we also are up to something else interesting. This has been in the works for a long time. David Niosi, the most recent former president of the American Humanist Association. He's also currently the president of the Secular Coalition for America, which AHA belongs to. Just got to do something very, very cool. He got to argue in front of the Massachusetts Supreme Court that the under God aspect of the Pledge of Allegiance is violating not federal law, not the Establishment Clause of the Constitution, which a lot of these cases have been about, but in this case, specifically state law guaranteeing equal protection of the laws, saying that this phrase specifically discriminates against non-religious people and sets them up as second-class citizens. And he's been working on this case a long time and just got to argue it this month in front of the Supreme Court there. It's pretty cool. Now, you were watching the video, Kim. What did you think?
Yes. It was happy chills. I was amazed at, you know, I watched a lot of stuff. This was interesting to me that the judges were actually questioning him. It sounded like arguments to me, but then, you know, I have my own perspective. He was presenting about the indoctrination, and he actually used that word, in the classroom daily was essentially, you know, the base part of why equal protection needed to be the issue here. And one of the judges asked him, he said, well, after, you know, when this court opened, we make the court call, and then the bailiff says, may God be with the Commonwealth, and was like, is that a problem? And kept trying to ask if that was, you know, why is that not an issue? And David was amazing, taking the argument right back to where it needed to be, and that the difference between opening court every morning and the difference between indoctrinating children daily in a school situation with peer pressure and led by teachers was a way different situation than a court call. It was stunning. I had chills. It was wonderful.
This is certainly the most creative case we've had in a long time, and we are really hopeful on it. We'll see how it plays out, but if we win, this could be a game changer, and then may open up the ability to try federal courts under the 14th Amendment. We'll see. So we'll find out in a couple of months. The court has to wait and decide, but kudos to Dave. He's an awesome, awesome guy, and very brave of him to work on this case this far, and I wish him the absolute best of luck. It'd be so freaking cool if we could win this one.
It really would. And, you know, I've been seeing a lot of polls that are coming out that a lot of Americans are actually in favor of not even having the pledge, but definitely taking the under God out of it, which was surprising to me considering what we see a lot in the media about how people feel about atheists.
I mean, me personally, I'm kind of conservative here, like really conservative when it comes to the pledge. Like, I want to restore it to its original form. To me, that's being conservative. It's kind of ironic that the religious conservatives, like, keep it in. It's like, no, you edited it. More than half of its existence under God was not in there. Let's put it back to the way it was, person who wrote it, the pastor who wrote it, wanted it, and get over this Cold War stuff. So I think it's so important. I mean, one little piece that I thought is very interesting side note on this is Jessica Alquist, the hero from Rhode Island who fought back against a official school, public school prayer banner in her school, told me that right after all this stuff heated up and went public, that in class the next day, they're reciting the Pledge of Allegiance, and her entire class turned to her and screamed under God when they got to that part of the pledge. Like, that right there makes it crystal clear what the problem is, because her classmates all saw it as, wait, you're wrong. We've been told our whole lives every morning that this is one nation under God. And now you're saying we shouldn't have an official school prayer? No. You're wrong. Of course we should have an official school prayer. The government told us we should be under God. It's like, no. The government's been wrong the whole time, and this is actually being used to discriminate against people. I can't tell you how often I see under God posted or in God we trust posted on blogs and forums when people are trying to justify why we should shut up or move out of the country or give up on our civil rights. Like, this is supposed to be one nation under God, and, you know, of course the government should be involved in religion and build us free crosses and restore our churches. And it's like, no. So hopefully we kick some tail on this case.
Absolutely. Jessica and everybody else, we're fighting there. We're fighting. Good job, David.
Welcome to the show, Marty. It's great to have you. I just want to start by saying a huge thank you for interviewing Dan Savage for us last month and being our guest host interviewer for August. That was really awesome. So thank you so kindly. I appreciate it, man.
It was my pleasure. And actually doing the research to get ready for the interview with Dan was actually very interesting. So I'm glad I had the chance to do that.
Did you learn anything you hadn't heard of before?
Well, I learned more about the It Gets Better project, which I didn't realize just how big it had become. The It Gets Better project started out as a little video project where he and Dan and his husband were basically doing a YouTube explaining to young gay kids, look, I know your life may suck now, but like mine did when I was your age, but trust me, it's going to get better. And their goal was to get 100 YouTubes from 100 different people. And they wound up getting 100,000, including from Obama, including from some Hollywood celebrities, including from the staff at NASA. So learning a little bit more about that project was interesting.
Oh, how inspiring.
Yeah.
Well, I want to talk to you, and I know Kim does as well. She's been gobbling up your book, your most recent book, Sexual Intelligence. And I want to hear about that. So first, what do you mean by sexual intelligence?
Well, sexual intelligence is the combination of skills and psychological abilities that we need to create the kind of sex that we find enjoyable. It's skills, psychological abilities, and accurate information. And you put that all together and you have sexual intelligence. You have the information you need to make good decisions. You have the decision-making skills you need to make good decisions. You have the communication skills you need to talk to your partner about the kind of sex that you want to have. And you have the self-awareness that you need and the self-acceptance that you need to be able to talk frankly to your partner. So you put all those together, and that's what I call sexual intelligence.
Which was absolutely fascinating to me because, okay, normalcy was fantastic. I have a 9-year-old daughter, and she's getting into that social situations now where everybody's wondering what's normal, right? 9-year-olds, they want to know what's normal for people. And it was amazing for me to be able to, I was reading this book and I was like, well, of course, your book is a little much for a 9-year-old, but your views on normalcy are timeless and they need to be in everyone's head in the world.
Well, thank you. My patients are forever asking me what's normal, but it's not only my patients. On Valentine's Day, which is a big day in the sex therapy field every year, mm-hmm. on Valentine's Day, I get calls from USA Today and from the London Guardian and, you know, from media outlets all over the world, and everybody wants to know what's normal in terms of, you know, what's the normal amount of sex that newlyweds have, or what's the normal amount of time that intercourse should last, or what's the normal amount of gallons of ejaculate that a guy should, expel during orgasm or whatever. And everybody wants to, you're right, Kim, everybody wants to know what's normal sexually, and it's a question that I just don't answer in a straightforward way because I think the answer itself can be part of the problem, not part of the solution.
Sorry, but I think this gallons of ejaculate thing is a little bit ridiculous. Everyone knows we should measure ejaculate in the metric system, okay? Let's just get that straight.
Liters.
Yes, liters. How many liters? Of semen.
Oh, yes, and nobody should use Todd as a measuring stick. Yeah, and that's the whole point of normalcy, right, Dr. Klein?
That's right. That's
right. Don't measure yourself by someone else's standards or what's normal for them. That is wonderful. One of the things that I enjoyed most about your book was your sense of humor about it, because it's, you had just mentioned about having the information to work with and knowing yourself. And I thought, well, that's kind of the overlying part of your book that to me is really important as a human being, that I think other people should read it, is your sense of humor about sex, about being human and about relating with each other.
Well, sex is too important to not have a sense of humor about it. And part of what makes sex difficult for people is that they get so grim when they get into bed. They get so grim because for so many people, the stakes are so high that each time they get into bed with somebody, it's an opportunity to fail. It's an opportunity to show that you're a miserable human being. It's an opportunity to show that you're not a real man or you're not a real woman. It's an opportunity to prove that you're not as attractive as the last person your partner had sex with. So for a lot of people, sex is a situation that's fraught with so much danger. And I don't mean the danger of catching a disease. I mean the psychological danger of exposing how inadequate you are. And with that kind of perspective, it's impossible to have a sense of humor. It's impossible to take things lightly. It's impossible when somebody leans on your hair accidentally, it's impossible to laugh about it. So I'm glad that you laughed while you were reading the book. I think it's important that we remind ourselves and each other that, you know, it's only sex, and it's only this one time. There's going to be another time.
Marty, for the listeners out there that might be considering learning more about sex and going out and buying a book about it, why should they choose your book over one of the others out there? Because there's a lot of them out there.
Because it has a pretty cover.
Oh, that's a good reason.
It does. It really does.
You know, choose my book, don't choose my book. Have a nice day, folks. No, what I aspire to when I wrote this book, and in fact, this book includes a critique of a lot of other self-help approaches, self-help that doesn't help, basically. My mission statement in this book was to help people understand, number one, that sex has to be custom tailored to each individual and to each couple. So part of my mission statement with this book was to help people understand sex is there for you, the reader, to shape the way that you want it, not for you to fit into the box that you think sex presents to you. And then to continue that mission statement on the book then tells people, okay, how do you do that? What ideas do you need to let go of, and what ideas do you need to have in order to create the kind of sex that you personally want and the kind of sex that you and your partner want? So the tagline on the book is, sex is not just an activity, it's an idea. And so the book is not about where do you put your leg, or, you know, what color hat you ought to wear if you want to have a better orgasm. The book is about what kinds of ideas do you need to have, and what kinds of ideas do you need to let go of if you and your partner want to create whatever kind of sex you're going to find enjoyable. And that's why people should buy the book.
And I would agree with that. After having read it, I was like, oh, yes, oh, yes. Well, not like that, but like that makes sense. A lot of it really did.
So the promotion for the book is going to be, this is the book that made Kim say, oh, yes, oh, yes.
Yeah. Yes.
when you do the paperback printing, you could just put that on the back as a review.
Kim,
book's available in 12 or 13 languages by now. It's available in Spanish and Portuguese and Italian and...
How about Hebrew? Is it? Can we get a review of Oy Vey, Oy Vey from Kim?
Very good. Very
yes.
good.
I find it fascinating talking to you two in particular about this. I mean, A, Marty, just because you're an expert in this, and B, something you may not know, which Kim may be embarrassing for you, but Kim's business that her and her husband run is actually a IT forensics company that often is going through like hard drives. So
yeah.
Kim has all sorts of fascinating stories about the crazy stuff found on people's hard drives, often involving sex. And of course, like, what is it, Kim? Pretty much 100% of hard drives have some sort of pornography on them.
Yes, absolutely. It's true.
So it's just the degree to which what is normal for each person, how intense does the pornography get, I guess.
Yes, and of course intense being, you know, it's different for different people. And I think, Dr. Klein, you can probably relate, not even probably, you will relate to this, because that line of what's normal is so very different. We've learned we have to be very careful when we talk to a lot of the people that come to us are spouses that have suspicions that their spouse is not acting how they expected them to, we'll put it that way. But the line of what's pornography for different people is amazingly different. We might have somebody, I mean, we have, I think this, I can say this without revealing too much, but we'll say a gentleman who apparently, and completely unbeknownst to his wife, he liked to dress up like a Hooters girl, complete with the pantyhose and, you know, the whole actual uniform and a wig and everything. And things like that happen often enough that is actually normal. That's a normal day at work for me now, which, you know, it sounds funny, but it's true. It just becomes normal. And yet there was another day that a lady came in and found out that her husband liked to look at women dressed up like superheroes. And it wasn't even pornographic. It was just women dressed up like superheroes. And she was horrified that he would do something like that. So I can imagine that a typical day for you in a different way is pretty much a typical day for us as well.
Right, and that's absolutely accurate. And, you know, what's interesting is that we have hundreds of TV channels, and everybody thinks that's a reasonable thing, and there's been a jillion movies that have been made in the world, and there's been 20 jillion artworks, you know, paintings, and 20 jillion sculptures that have been made in the world, and they're all different. And some of them are attractive to you, and some of them are repulsive to you, and some of them are attractive to me, and some of them are boring to me. And nobody thinks twice about that. People think, of course we live in a world where we need to have Van Gogh and Andy Warhol at the same time. Of course we live in a world where we need the Three Stooges and the Maltese Falcon at the same time. So logic suggests that when it comes to sexuality, it would be exactly the same thing, that you would want porn that looks like this, and somebody else would want to look at porn that looks like that. But somehow people don't make that logical leap. People assume that pornography has to fit in some narrow band, or else it's going to be abnormal, or that people have to want to look or enjoy looking at a certain limited selection of visual images, or else there's something wrong with them. It would be the equivalent of saying, well, it's normal to enjoy Casablanca, but it's not normal to enjoy Lawrence of Arabia. Or it's normal to enjoy Andy Warhol, but it's abnormal to enjoy Van Gogh or the Mona Lisa. So when it comes to sexuality, there is the same infinite taste for imagery that there is in every other art form, whether it's music or cinema or sculpture or advertising or anything else.
Do you find in your practice that your humanist and non-religious clients have a greater acceptance of their own sexuality than religious customers, or do you find that to be roughly equal?
I think it's about the same. I mean, everybody, whether they're a theist or an atheist, whether they're humanist or not, you know, everybody is struggling with a culture that is so twisted about sexuality. So no matter what you believe today about the validity of the human body or the validity of human experience or whatever, we're constantly pressured by whether it's advertising or fashion or religion or history. I mean, religion has an enormous effect on atheists, whether it's because as an 8-year-old you have to recite the Pledge of Allegiance that says one nation under God, or whether it's because you have to put up with a city council that includes a prayer at the meeting, or whether it's because when there's a debate about war, the newspaper feels obliged to tell us what the Pope has to say about it, like I actually care. So religion is a big force in people's lives, whether they're atheist or religious or somewhere in between. When people wear their religion on their sleeve, or as is actually the case, when people wear their religion around their neck, it's an easy invitation as a therapist to say, well, let's talk about that. But sooner or later, what people are wrestling with is not so much religion versus humanism. What people are wrestling with is self-acceptance or self-criticism. What people are wrestling with is my body okay or is my body not okay? And unfortunately, religion does not have a monopoly in making people feel bad about themselves.
Yeah, that's another, especially having a 9-year-old daughter now and making sure that we get the, I don't like to use the word right, but I guess positive messages out there early. It's amazing how soon this stuff can start.
Speaking of kids, my son is 10, my daughter is 8, and we're certainly to the age where they pick up on the jokes they used to not pick up on. I used to have great fun throwing around double entendres that they simply didn't get that other people did. I guess yes. The most striking example of when that ended was when my son brought home a model of the human lungs, and he's talking about how these two little balloons are the lungs, the two little straws are like the equivalent of the windpipe, and you pull on this other balloon at the bottom, and that's like the diaphragm. And I cut a little sophomoric diaphragm joke to my wife and some friends in the room, and they chuckle, and Cole's like, What? I don't get it. And I was like, oh, nothing. So we leave, we come home, and we find when we get home that he has opened up Google and looked up diaphragm. He's like,
yeah.
Like, oh, yeah, that's right. Information is available. So, Marty, what are your thoughts. How open should parents be with their children about what sex is and what it isn't? Should they be careful? Are there certain ages where you really should hide some of it? What would your advice be to me and other parents out there?
Well, that's a great question. And I don't think that there's one right answer for every family. You know, that's like the question, at what age should I no longer walk around the house nude in front of my kids? And I think the answer to that is it depends on you, it depends on the kid, and it depends on your family. So for some families, you can do that when you can still do that when your kid is seven, but for other families, I think that would be a problem. You know, it all depends on the family. So my answer to your overall question, which I think is a really, really great question, my answer is, for the most part, it depends. Having said that, let's look at some guidelines. In general, we have to remember that kids have access to information when we're not around, like your kid looking up diaphragm, right? We have to remember that you can try and hide things from your kids, but you may not succeed. And for the most part, when parents want to hide things from kids, while most parents do that out of a sense of love and concern and responsibility, on the one hand, on the other hand, a lot of what parents are actually doing is they're trying to protect their own butt. They're trying to protect themselves from having to have uncomfortable conversations or conversations where they don't want to have to answer questions about themselves. It's one of the reasons that parents don't talk to their kids about drugs, because inevitably a kid is going to say, well, when you were 14, did you smoke dope? Or, you know, when you were in college, did you try cocaine? And a lot of parents don't want to answer those questions, and so they just don't talk about drugs with their kids altogether. And I think the same is true with sexuality. You know, how old were you, mommy, when you first had sex? What about you, daddy? Did you ever, you know, have sex with another guy? Things like that. So it's good to be mindful about what we tell kids. But if we're going to deliberately not tell them stuff, it's important, I think, to be honest with ourselves as parents about why we don't want to do that. So that's one thing. Another thing is kids need a vocabulary with which to talk about sex. Kids need, just like they need to know the name of their shoulder, and they need to know what's a reasonable expectation of what a shoulder can do, kids also need words to describe penis, vulva, orgasm, erection, and kids need that at what some of us might think of as a young age. I mean, kids need to know the name of their penis, certainly when they're 8 years old. I mean, it's not like it's darkest Africa down there. It's an actual body part, vulva, penis. So kids need a vocabulary. Kids need to know, what kids need to know more than anything is that they can ask their parents questions. Kids need to know more than anything. If you ever have a question about sex or anything else, you can come and ask me, and I won't harangue you. You know, if a kid says, mommy, what's a blow? If the answer to that question is, why are you asking me that? That's a terrible question. Only naughty girls ask that question. You know, you can say to the kid, now, is there anything else you want to ask me? But the kid's going to get the message, oh, I get it. There are certain questions you don't ask parents. So we need to let kids know, if you have any questions, you should ask me. And I guess the last thing I want to say to your terrific and very broad question is that talking to your kids about sex is not a one-time event. It's not like you sit down with them when they're, 25 years old and talk to them about what is sex and why should you have it and how do you make decisions and things like that. No, talking about sex is a 20-year process. You start talking to kids about sex when they're 2 or 3 years old, when you're bathing them, and you say, oh, what a nice belly, oh, what a nice kneecap, and you don't talk about what's in between. That's sex education, too. So we talk to kids about sexuality year after year after year after year in the same way that we talk about nutrition year after year after year. We don't talk to kids about nutrition just once. We talk to kids about nutrition year after year after year, and the older and the more sophisticated they get, the more sophisticated the conversations become. So at 6 years old, the conversation about nutrition might be no candy before dinner. Why? Because I said so. You know, or no candy before dinner. Why? Because you'll spoil your appetite. When kids are 15 years old, they don't need the no candy before dinner lecture. They need a different conversation. They need a conversation about why oily foods may taste good, but why oily foods in general are not so good for you. Telling a five-year-old oily foods are not good for you, and let me tell you why, you know, that goes right over their head. So it's the same thing, you know, with sexuality. You don't tell a six-year-old when you have intercourse, use a condom. That just go right over their head. But a six-year-old, you know, you can say, if somebody wants to kiss you and you don't want to kiss them, don't kiss them. You know, or if you want to kiss somebody and they don't want to kiss you, say okay and don't do it. You know, don't force them. You know, whereas at 15, it's a different conversation. And now, not to get off on pornography quite yet, if we're going to talk to kids about pornography when they're 13 or 14 years old, you don't want that to be the first conversation that you as a parent have with your kid about sex. You don't want to be silent about sex for 10 or 12 years and then say, well, I guess it's time to talk about pornography. Listen, stay away from that crap. It's not good for you. No, if you want to have a meaningful conversation with your kid about pornography when they're 13 years old, what you really want to have had is a long series of conversations about sex and gender and relationships and love and bodies so that there's some context for a conversation about pornography when they're 13 years old. So that's my long answer to your very good question.
Now, that was a great answer. I actually get your subscribe to your blog as well, and the post you had on talking to your kids about porn was very helpful, and not something
good
that I had even thought about, because I deal with porn every day. It's become normal here, so sometimes I have to look at things through a different lens, and I was like, oh, that makes sense. And they don't talk about, I have some great, you know, what's happening to my body type books for my daughter that are fantastic. They don't talk about porn. And the fact of the matter is the kids are growing up in a very visual age with all the technology, and it's a big deal.
Correct.
Yeah.
Absolutely correct. So if you wait until, first of all, if you wait until your kid says to you, Mom, I have questions about pornography, forget that, right? That would be like never telling your kid about how to brush their teeth and then waiting until they're 12 years old and they say, hey, Mom, I notice everybody else has white teeth and my teeth are blue. Do you think maybe we ought to do something about this? No, we don't wait for kids to ask us how to take care of their teeth. We say to kids, I know you're not in the mood to learn about this, but you're going to learn how to brush your teeth and you're going to do it and we're going to talk about it. So it's the same thing with porn. You can't, and sex in general, by the way, you can't wait around until your kid asks you about it because they're not as smart as a parent is. A parent knows that a kid needs to understand porn way before a kid knows that. And a parent knows what some of the troubling issues are about pornography or sexuality way before a kid knows that. You know, a kid is not going to walk up to you when they're 9 years old and say, could we please talk about broken hearts? I'm concerned, you know, that in a year or two or in a week or two or last week, you know, like there's this girl in my class who I really like and she didn't like me and I have a broken heart. No, you can't wait around until kids ask you questions like that. We have to be proactive. We have an affirmative obligation to raise the subject of sexuality with our kids and to talk to them about it.
I like that phrase, affirmative. Affirmative obligation.
We have an affirmative obligation.
I like it.
I sometimes wonder if I tell my kids too much because, I mean, I'm ridiculously open. I try not to get, like, disgusting or anything, but I pretty much don't hide anything. I'm kind of full disclosure kind of guy. I mean, is there anything you shouldn't tell your kids? Are there things you should hold back on?
I think the answer is mostly a function of what do you want kids to learn. So, for example, I think the concept of privacy is really important. You know, most of us, at some point or other, we close the bathroom door when we're in the bathroom. I don't know about how it goes in your house, Todd, but in most houses, there's some activity or other where mom or dad closes a bathroom door, and what the kid learns from that is, oh, there are times when a certain amount of privacy is allowed. Or when, you know, parents want alone time to cuddle or whatever, and they close the bedroom door and they tell their kids, you know, we'll be out in a half hour, go away. Or when someone says, I want to make a private phone call, I'm going to go into the kitchen, please don't come into the kitchen. So I think the concept of privacy and personal space and personal boundaries is really important, and we want to teach that along with everything else that we want to teach. So when a kid says to you, well, what about you? You know, do you go down on mom? You know, I think for the most part the answer to do you go down on mom kind of question would be, you know, that's the kind of private thing about me that I don't necessarily want to talk about with you. not because there's anything wrong with it, but because that's kind of within my private zone. And while we're on the subject, let me teach you about the difference between privacy and secrecy. See, it's not a secret, it's just private. A secret is when you feel ashamed of something, or when you feel embarrassed, or when you feel guilty, or when you think you did something wrong, or when you're afraid if other people know they're gonna, you're gonna get in trouble and all that. But privacy is different. Privacy is what everybody has a right to just by virtue of being a person. You have a zone of privacy around you, and you have the right to maintain that little zone. And if anybody says to you, you have no right to privacy, your body is mine, or your thoughts are mine, or this or that, I think there's something wrong with that, and maybe you want to come and tell me about that.
I like that, the difference between secrecy and privacy. There's a,
that's from my first book, all the way back in 1988, before you were born, Kim. All the way back in 1988, I wrote a book called Your Sexual Secrets, When to Keep Them, When and How to Tell. And I talked about the difference between privacy and secrecy.
Yeah, it's actually a really good point. It has a lot to do with the feelings that you have with that secret or that private thing, which I really like. And I was alive and well in the 80s. Thank you very much. and learning all this stuff for the first time. That's really funny. One of the things that I was surprised at, which I shouldn't have been when I thought about it, but at first, was how much of, you know, I'm a child of the 80s. I was born in the 70s. How much of my generation and the ones before me were affected by the Masters and Johnson work? And
now there's a new TV show coming out about Masters and Johnson, right?
Oh, I don't know.
Yes, it's called Masters of Sex. This is not a plug for the show. I'm assuming it's going to be awful, but I interrupted you, Kim. Please continue. You were talking about Masters and Johnson.
Oh, no, that's actually kind of interesting, because you had mentioned, well, there was a couple of things in the books where you had mentioned, you know, some of their findings and how they've kind of been misused over the years, and how that can be issues for people who are laboring under the misconception that this is what sex is, just because of some of the work that they did.
Yeah, Masters and Johnson were absolutely revolutionary, and it's hard to remember. It's hard to remember, but just to give you a sense, my first year in college was 1967. Now, you're not going to tell me you were alive then, Kim. So I entered college in 1967, and I went to one of the most progressive universities on the face of the earth. And at this very progressive university, there were dorms for guys, dorms for young women, and they were in separate places, and you were not allowed to visit a dorm of the other gender after 10 o'clock in the evening on weekdays, and I think it was 11 o'clock or 12 o'clock on the weekend. But there was even a control on how much you were allowed to visit the dorm of the other gender. And so, of course, the school was filled with traditions of that, people, climbing out of windows at 3 o'clock in the morning and all that. But imagine that sexual world where there was that radical separation of the two genders and an attempt, a radical attempt to control the sexual behavior of each other. Now, that was in 1967. The birth control pill had just been invented, and that changed everything. And Masters and Johnson had just started publishing their work in 1964. So that's the world. That's the Mad Men, if you know that show. That's the Mad Men world that Masters and Johnson walked into, where homosexuality was considered a disease. It was only back in the 60s. Homosexuality was considered a disease, and the clitoris had not yet been invented.
Glad I got one.
Exactly. So Masters and Johnson did this amazing thing. They actually measured what happens to the human body during sex. What happens to heart rate? What happens to skin temperature? What happens to eye dilation? What happens to vaginal lubrication? What happens to anal muscles? You know, they actually measured. Nobody had done this before in North America, and it was as radical in its own way as what Kinsey did back in the 40s and 50s. Kinsey documented what people do. Masters and Johnson documented what does the body do. And so what Kinsey was about is what are the choices that people make. And what Masters and Johnson did was to measure, well, when people are doing what they choose to do, what are their bodies doing? And the dominant metaphor of the age back in the 60s was the machine. Now, of course, it's the computer. The dominant metaphor back then, things were about streamlined trains and rockets to outer space and how machines were going to change everything. So Masters and Johnson put together their data and basically conceptualized the human body as a machine and talked about what are the different parts of the machine actually go through as part of sexual experience. And they arranged this data in what they called the sexual response cycle. It assumed that most people were going to have an orgasm as the climax of sexual activity, and it assumed that sex was going to mostly involve penis-vagina intercourse, and which back then for most people it did. Now, of course, oral sex and anal sex, far more common. You know, now about 90% of adults have experienced, or in America, have experienced oral sex one way or another. Back then in the early 60s, oral sex was considered exotic by most people. And kind of, I would say that today, anal sex is talked about and done more than oral sex was talked about and done in 1960.
Wow.
So even oral sex was considered exotic, and not everybody did it, and it was, some people thought it was only something that prostitutes did. And so it was a very different world, and Masters and Johnson, in their own way, were as revolutionary as Kinsey in that they actually talked about, well, what happens to the human body, and what is sexual response? And then Sherhide built on that a few years later when she did talk about the clitoris, and she said, you know, most American women, they're not climaxing from just penis-vagina intercourse alone. They're not climaxing from having something put in and out of their vagina all by itself. That most American women who are having orgasms, according to Sherhide and subsequent researchers, it was because of clitoral stimulation. And that was a big discovery. So I forget the question, but that's my answer.
I mean, it's on the same topic, but kind of a different vein. So something that has been running through my head based on some conversations over the last few months, something I kind of guess I don't fully understand, which is apparently there's a number of people into S&M and bondage and things like that. And apparently some women need it more than their man can. And even if they ask their man to dominate them, it's not enough. They need something. Their method of dominating is too meek or whatever. They need some like serious dominating. What is going on there? Is that, what's the root cause of that? And back to kind of the normalcy question, is this normal? Is it not normal? Is it a deep seated root from, you know, daddy issues? Or I'm not the therapist. So enlighten us, please.
Well, that's about 10 different questions in there.
Yeah.
So let me start by changing the question. It's not about women needing this and men not being able to provide that. It's people. I mean, some people, they want a certain kind of sexual experience, and their partner is either not interested or not able to provide that experience. And that's not limited to S&M, by the way. I mean, you know, some women will say, you know, I want lots and lots of intercourse, and some men will say, you know, either I don't like doing that, or I'd love to do that, but I'm sorry, I can't provide that. So that dynamic is not just about S&M. But to focus on the S&M thing that you were talking about, S&M or sadomasochism or dominance and submission or bondage and discipline, some people talk about that as an orientation, like same-gender sex. Other people talk about it as, this is just my preference. Either way, it involves a bunch of physical stuff and or a bunch of psychological stuff. You know, for some people, the dominating and the submitting has to do with physicality. It has to do with, I'm gonna hold your wrist down and I'm gonna spank you. Or I'm gonna force you to kiss me when, we're gonna pretend that you don't want to kiss me and then I'm gonna force you to kiss me. For other people, it's explicitly psychological. It's, we're gonna pretend that I'm holding you captive and I get to dictate what you're going to do. Or we're going to pretend that we've never met and we're going to go to a bar and I'm going to pick you up. Or, you know, we're going to go to a bar and you're going to pretend to be available and I'm going to watch other men flirt with you and I'm going to watch you get all excited about that. So the main thing is not necessarily physical pain, and it's not necessarily humiliation. It's not necessarily one thing. The main thing is about the power dynamic. My friend Bill Henkin, the psychologist in San Francisco, coined the expression erotic power play. And I really like that expression. It's the conscious playing with the erotic side of power. It's the playing, it's the conscious playing with the power dynamics in erotic relationships. So it's mostly about trust, and it's mostly about sharing, because it's not something you do to someone, it's something you do with someone. And it's something that involves a lot of communication. It pairs physical, typically pairs physical and psychological experiences at the same time. So somebody might like to be spanked, but if they bump into a piece of furniture, they say, ow, that's no fun, but then they like to be spanked. So there are some couples where some people, you know, one person likes that more than the other person, or one person likes that and the other person doesn't like it or want it at all. And that's just part of the normal dynamics in couples. I mean, it's rare that you get two people in a couple and they both like Chinese food exactly the same amount, or they both like watching science fiction films exactly the same amount. It's very rare. And it's true with sex, too. It's very rare that you get two people who like exactly the same kind of sex or exactly the complementary roles in a sexual situation. And so what grown-ups do is they sort of negotiate and they sort of horse trade a little bit, and they say, well, you know, I'll do a little bit more of this, but I don't want to do that other thing. And, well, maybe I'd be more willing to do this if you explained to me why you like it so much. Or I'd be willing to do more of this, but not as frequently as you might want to do it. So I'm willing to do it occasionally, but don't take that as me saying, okay, I'm willing to do it all the time. So what grown-ups do about contrasting sexual interests is what they do about contrasting interests in restaurants and film and child-rearing philosophies and everything else, which is they talk about it. They don't criticize each other. They talk about it and they negotiate and they find out more information about each other. You know, what does this mean to you? Why is this enjoyable to you? Why is this scary to you? So, you know, like with you and your kid, you know, you say you're very open talking to your kid about sex. Your partner might say, Todd, you know, do you have to talk to our kid about so-and-so? And you might say, well, let me explain to you why this is important to me. You know, rather than her saying, you know, Todd, you're just a jerk, and you saying, no, 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 you're just a jerk. So what grown-ups have to do in every relationship is understand the other person better and talk about, why is this important to me? Why is this important to you? Let's negotiate.
One of the things that I really enjoyed about the book is that you use a lot of examples and a lot of analogies so that the reader isn't just sitting there trying to figure out what you're talking about from a lot of technical gobbledygook. And one of there's some great suggestions that you have, and we are talking about communicating now, and that's what made me think about it, because I was reading your book in many different places. You know, I'm a businesswoman and a mom, and I'm constantly on the go, so I always have a book with me, and trying to smuggle sexual intelligence around as I'm, you know, as I'm running around the city of Raleigh and not making other people, you know, nobody's kids need to see what I'm reading necessarily. But I was in my daughter's orthodontist office, and I got to the part where you where some ideas on communicating with your partner, and you likened being like Amazon.com. Well, since you like X, I wonder if you'd like to try Y. And
I had forgotten that, but you're right. I just say that.
It was hysterical. I laughed out loud, and three mothers turned their head to me, and I had to smile and wave like I was in my own world. But that was one of the funniest parts of the book to me. There was a lot of moments. For the readers who are potential readers who haven't yet, the book is full of wonderful moments like that that really bring the human aspect to the craziness that is human sex.
Thank you. Thank you. So, for example, we do that all the time. You know, we say, gee, since we like that new Italian restaurant last week, I was thinking this week we might like that other Italian place that's in the next city. Or, you know, since you like that Italian place and the noodles and the spaghetti in that Italian place last week, I was thinking we could have some Chinese noodles next week, right? So we do that sort of instinctively all the time. Amazon's sort of copying the human brain when it does that. So we can do that with sexuality also. You know, gee, I never realized you like to be spanked, but, you know, if you like to be spanked on the butt, I was wondering if you want to be spanked on the thighs. Or, you know, since you liked since you like wearing that blindfold last week, I was wondering if maybe we could get some handcuffs and, you know, tie your wrists back behind your head. So that's what I meant by that sort of thing. And it's really the way the human mind works. We are pattern-seeking animals. That's what makes us different from other mammals. We seek to see patterns, and we seek to create patterns. That's what religion, you know, partly is about. That's what superstition is about, seeing patterns where they don't exist or creating patterns out of disparate things.
Marty, would you like to tell our listeners where they can learn more about you and where they can find your books?
Well, to learn more about me, you have to marry me. But my books, they're available both on Amazon.com and on my website, which is sexed.org, S-E-X-E-D.org. I have some books for sale, some audios. There's lots of free information there, articles about various aspects of sexuality. My blog, Sexual Intelligence, is there. It's all at sexed.org. And my Twitter feed, I've now learned how to say this, my Twitter feed is at drmartyklein.
I put in another plug for your book, America's War on Sex, The Attack on Law, Lust, and Liberty, for those of you who are interested in the separation of church and state and the lack thereof and some of the stories behind it. That's a fantastic book as well.
Marty, thanks so much for coming on the show. We really appreciate it.
Thank you. My pleasure.
So, listeners, that was Marty Klein. I had a lot of fun with that one, although I have to say, Kim, my favorite part was when he transitioned to pornography a little early and said not to get off on porn too early.
Yeah, it was hard not to giggle like, well, like we're used to doing. Get off on porn. Who does that? Nobody.
Can you get off on porn too early? I mean, especially if you're by yourself. You know, hey, what is, who cares how long it takes?
We do. Some people have time constraints. We shouldn't judge, remember? Normal is different for everybody.
This is true. This is true. And normal is different for the FCC. So for all
That's
of our
right.
for all of our radio markets out there. Sorry, I think that passes. I think there's only seven words we can't say. So
yeah. Oh, where is George Carlin when you need him?
Awesome. So listeners, we need to give you the 411 on some stuff on the show. You can check out previous episodes, show notes, including links to all sorts of cool things about this episode at thehumanisthour.org. You can check us out at our listener comment line and call us and tell us how awesome we are or how awful we are, whatever you think, at 202-618-1371. And of course, like us on Facebook.
Yay. I like us on Facebook.
You do like us?
Mm-hmm.
Do you like yourself on Facebook, or is that impossible?
I don't think Facebook lets you do that yet, but I'm sure it's coming. Sometimes I like my own comments because I'm, you know.
you upvote yourself?
Yeah. Yeah, I do.
That seems reasonable. All right. Awesome. Well, that is our show for the month. We have another great guest next month who is Nikki Stern, an author and speaker at the recent conference. So this is not a pre-recorded one. We'll be doing it in the next couple of weeks, and it's going to be really exciting.
Yay, Nikki Stern. I'm excited.
Indeed. Kim, do you have anything else you want to talk about before we sign off?
No. I just guess, you know, be excellent to one another. Have a Bill and Ted's kind of day.
Indeed. All right, listeners, be excellent to each other. Ziggy piggy, ziggy piggy. All right, Google it, kids.
Oh,
goodness. All right, till next month. Take it easy, everybody.
Bye.
Yeah, 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 girl. Come over here. Yeah, yeah, come talk to me. Come talk to me a second. Yeah. I'm cocky and single, and I got your jeans tingling, girl. With my Cosby signaling, I'm rocking the rhythm, and all you keep thinking about is the offspring we're bringing to the world. You're awfully tempting, see, got my jeans tingling too. With your Cosby signaling, you're cute, but you gotta be considerate and have a sense of humor, or you will not be interesting. Charles Darwin saw natural selection as the most serious cause of evolution. But what was going on with bird songs and peacocks? They follow mysterious laws. And then Darwin had a curious thought. It probably occurred to him while explaining his theory to a young Victorian blonde whose face displayed a mixture of desire and feverish awe, the immediate cause of which Darwin clearly saw. So he said, "My dear, just
dissent with modification comes from the struggle for survival and reproduction. Hence the reason for some structures must indeed be seduction. In fact, Darwin's brain was probably one such structure. Just as peacock's tails show off the genes of the top males, and likewise the songs of nightingales and the fighting skills of elephant seals and minnows with colorful scales. See, these are all traits that sexual selection is shaped through the female preference to get with the fittest mates. But in human beings, selection goes both ways. Pretty much anything that's just for display and isn't meant to dissuade and chase predators away was probably selected for in a sexual way. But wait, isn't this just such a display? I mean, I really thought I had something to say, but is it just a demonstration of my DNA? And so what if it is?
That's great.
What's to explain? Okay, maybe a couple of things. First, to say that something ornate like language evolved as a seductive display doesn't mean that people only use it just to get laid. Darwin leaves Freud in the dustbin, okay? I could use a urine screen to put out a fire. That doesn't mean the penis evolved as a bush firefighter. This is a theory of language function, a theory of where it comes from. What it's used for, that's a separate discussion. So which was it? Was language originally a mechanism of survival or reproduction? Well, let me put it this way. Can you talk a predator out of attacking? Can you talk a parasite out of infecting? Can you talk a potential mate into consenting? Potentially, right? Not necessarily, but potentially. Yeah. I'm cocky and single, and I got your genes tingling, girl. With my costly signals, and I'm rocking the rhythm, and all you keep thinking about is the offspring we're bringing to the world, and you're awfully tempting, so you got my genes tingling too. With your costly signals, and you're cute, but you gotta be considerate and have a sense of humor, or you will not be interesting.
Alright, check this out, check this out.
Presenting the grand unified theory of rhyme. The mating mind uses lyrical signs combined with wit and wordplay and conversation and humor in different narrative styles to appraise the fitness of mates, both for the purpose of marriage ties and mates of the more temporary kind. These are the humble roots of the literary sublime. We are all Shakespearean primates verbalizing our cherry behinds. But how could we possibly test this theory of mine? Ideally, we could use experimental holding zoos filled with human subjects, and with an overhead view, we could observe which breeding pairs reproduce and how often they use their verbal ornaments to seduce. We could even separate them into control groups to see whether male or female vocals are more prone to be used to stimulate hormones, although it's true that this sort of experiment on humans isn't normally approved. If only there existed in a state of nature some cultural group preoccupied with making paper and parading naked women, shaking their moneymakers in front of competitive males displaying mating behavior while trading their creativity for sexual favors. If such a group existed, I predict it would be a major player in the entertainment industry and would be in major danger of being overwhelmed by angry player haters. But I may have to save some of my research for later. I'm cocky and single, and I got your genes tingling, girl. With my costly signals, and I'm rocking the rhythm, and all you keep thinking about is the offspring we're bringing to the world, and you're awfully tempting, so you got my genes tingling too. With your costly signals, and you're cute, but you gotta be considerate and have a sense of humor, or you will not be interesting. And how do I answer the charge that I'm participating in this mating dance myself with these dazzling bars? That isn't hard. I plead guilty. I worked hard to achieve this ability, and if it also gives my genes this ability, then so be it. But I confess, it also reveals my unique disability. See, my tendency to tell monkey fables and funny medieval tales generally fails to attract any nubile young females. It does attract women a lot, though. All highly educated and postmenopausal. I know, isn't it awful? I get mobbed after my Chaucer shows by grandmas thanking me for making it possible for them to appreciate a hip-hop flow. And you might ask, where are their granddaughters? My guess is they're at gangster rap concerts. But hey, that's how sexual selection works. Any mutation gets tested first, and if it doesn't get spread, then it gets purged. So this experimental hip-hop mix, where it gets crossed with literature and lectures, will probably get the burial that it deserves. That is, unless you spread it like whispers. Come here, I'm cocky and single, and I got your genes tingling, girl. With my costly singer, and I'm rocking the rhythm, and all you keep thinking about is the offspring we're bringing to the world, and you're awfully tempting, so you got my genes tingling too.
With your costly signal and your cue, but you gotta be considerate and have a sense of humor, or you will not be interesting. Cocky and single, and I got your jeans tingling, girl. With my costly signal, and I'm rocking the rhythm, and all you keep thinking about is the offspring we're bringing to the world. And you're awfully tempting, so you got my jeans tingling too. With your costly signal and your cue, but you gotta be considerate and have a sense of humor, or you will not be interesting. Yeah. Yeah, step into the area. Yeah, you and me, girl, we got different criteria. We gotta get over a couple barriers before I'm gonna marry ya. But for now, I just wanna get near to ya.